No, she's not here today.
Okay. This is one of my mom's favorite prayers, so I'm going to start with hers. This one, and you all know it. Go forth into the world in peace, be strong and of good courage. Hold fast that which is good. Love and serve the Lord with gladness and singleness of heart, rejoicing in the power of his Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Now I'm going to share.
Uh-oh.
Yeah. When your phone rings, you just mute.
Let me put it on mute.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay, good. Here we go. Can everybody see this?
Yes.
Okay. So thank you for those of you who are zoomed in today. Appreciate it. It's always a joy to think about my mom. And I say that because mom and my sister and even Shirley Perkins helped craft this book together, which there's still a couple copies downstairs in the office. And it's the story of Christ Church, she calls it. And when she got most of this information from the office files, the history of the church from the office files. And initially Shirley Perkins helped mom take some of the pictures, and they even went to this over to the cement plant and were traipsing all over the place, which I find it amusing to think about. And so I'd like to give Shirley credit, some credit today in helping mom in the beginning of this endeavor. And then my sister, who's a my older sister, Meg, who's a really wonderful editor. She was an editor for Sunset Magazine. She helped mom put the book together. And I just found out recently that was taken to Costco, and somewhere in the office, there should be the template and ability to make more copies. And that's about all I know. I talked to the church about that, and I'll have to follow up on that. So those are the people involved in putting it together. And I'm gonna just start by telling you a little bit about mom in case you didn't know her, if there's anybody out there that didn't know her. Mom was very involved in church, the Altar Guild, St. Catherine, she did talent shows. And probably part of the reason why she got so involved is we moved all over the country and all overseas. Her adult life, she just was traipsing all over the world. And at some point she just said, nope, that's it, to dad. And they went back to their house that they had bought on Evergreen Road, which now of course is gone. And she enjoyed her retirement. So I think she wanted to get involved in everything. So she was involved in, she decided to get the guild room all cleaned up. She decorated pillows, she bought pillows, she had the architectural drawing framed, she bought a rocking chair, she upholstered it. She just did things to make the guild room very, very comfortable. And that was kind of something that she took on. And the other kind of thing that she did that, you know, wasn't talked about a lot, and that's the way she wanted it, and probably one of the reasons why she wanted the guild room so nice, was that years ago, probably 8-10 years ago, she was at church and helping with the service, and a family came in. They were devastated. Their son had committed suicide, and mom kind of witnessed the service starting up and the family gathering, and there was no place to gather. And they were grief-stricken. And mom decided at that point, you know what? We're gonna make something so that people have a little spot to be private in, gather the family and all that. And so she created Lesser Saints. And she would be there at every service of a funeral with a pot of tea and some cookies and a bouquet of flowers and a And that was just something she wanted to do. And I don't know if it still goes on. Shirley took it on, but, and I think she got a couple people interested. But anyways, that tells you a little bit, just a little bit about Mom. So she got a bee in her bonnet about wanting folks to know the history of this church. And so my sister and her spent several months creating it. And so this is a brief overview based on this little book I just showed you. And I in no way consider myself a historian. So if you have a lot of questions, there may be folks in the audience today that could fill in some of the holes for me. So at the end of this, feel free to add your memories.
Well, I know Shirley is logged in.
Oh, good. Great.
She might have something to say.
Well, I'm going to touch on that. At the corner of Brayman Avenue and Palatine Hill, which is right up where Shirley used to live, stood St. Agnes Mission, whose cornerstone was laid in 1895. Attendance was good, but the burden of the $36 budget, as recorded in 1900, was too heavy, and attendance declined. Later, the pretty little mission burned to the ground, the cornerstone was rescued, and resides at our church in the Memorial Garden to remind us of our heritage. It is located underneath the guild room windows. Mm-hmm. And there it is. And we worked in the garden this weekend and cleaned up around the cornerstone and trimmed some of those bushes. 40 years later, owing to the drive of Mrs. Arneson and her friends in the Dunthorpe area, Bishop Dagwell organized a church school for the Oswego community. They met at the clubhouse of the Portland Cement Company, and on the second Sunday, it met at the Lake Theater. In 1943, the little church found a home in the Masonic Lodge on the corner of 2nd and A Street. A real congregation was starting to grow, and they were first known as Christ Church, then St. George, then St. Thomas, and then back to Christ Church. In 1943, that membership purchased the corner lot at Chandler and 10th Street. In 1945, Christ Church obtained mission status and started a building fund for the parish hall to be placed on the newly purchased lot. In 1947, a contract was signed to build the parish hall, and the second building campaign began for the sanctuary. On Thanksgiving Day, 1948, the Reverend E.E. West held the first service in the new parish hall, with the very first altar being a homemade box. Our new home was consecrated by Bishop Dagwell on December 19th, 1948. What we know as the narthex was the original body of the church. We'll go back to this for a minute. And it had a lively Sunday school overhead. So as an aside, my mom put in the book, they used folding chairs in those days, and every Sunday they were put up and taken down. When the eagerly awaited new pews arrived, they were unassembled and in boxes. Well, the congregation pitched in to help, but is it any wonder that a stone in memory of the very first sexton now rests along the pathway from the red doors? Because that guy was put his time in. He really worked hard on that. This 11th slide is a bulletin from 1949 that Adrian Brockman was kind enough to share with us. And I'm going to tell a little bit more about Adrian's comments and feedback about her history in just a little bit. Let's see here. 1951, the mortgage for the parish hall was burned, and in 1952, ground was broken for a new sanctuary. Um, this shows one of the drawings that was up for consideration by the church from I don't know who this architect was, this particular one. But the next slide shows a letter from Mary S. Young, who disapproved of those plans. She thought it was very pretentious and paying off its debts would be too huge for this community. She mentioned that she gave towards the building fund a few years ago. And if it were kept simple, you would not have to ask for additional subscriptions from those who have already subscribed. So I'm thinking that that's the Mary S. Young. Mm-hmm. Maybe folks will have something to say about that later today, but it's an interesting letter. Happily, in the congregation, there was a young architect relocated from Canada, Jerry Scott. Well, Jerry Scott's vision was in perfect harmony with the Pacific Northwest. His use of wood throughout the nave would make a shipbuilder proud, and he meant us always to be a village church. The original architectural rendering hangs over the fireplace in the guild room. In 1967, a development program was begun with the alteration of the chancel and sanctuary, the addition of a pipe organ, and the expansion of the nave, narthex, and office. And the two-story education wing was added at last. Later, gifts of stained glass windows replaced the original amber pebble glass, which Elaine remembers. These glowing jewels have told the stories of both the Old and New Testaments to the delight of generations of small children. I know, personally speaking, we came to the church in the 60s, lived off of Atwater Lane, and I would sit in the pews and they're mesmerizing. And just, they capture you for sure. And also Elaine mentioned that she remembered in the late 60s and 70s, there was stained glass behind the altar, which was new to me to hear. The Jubilee vision from 1895 to 1995, as we celebrated our past 100 years of ministry, a plan was initiated for the work of the next 100. Hence Jubilee Vision. It began with the old 10th Street Rectory going down on wheels down A Street to its new home on the corner of 7th and A. This made room for the new parish hall, offices, and parking. A spirited campaign was launched to build a new parish, remodel the chapel, bring all the building up to code, and create the memorial garden. Owing to the vision and skilled diplomacy of Father Tom Cummings, the new parish came to life, and Bishop Ladoff dedicated it as Cummings Hall in 2000. The memorial chapel was renovated and reconsecrated as St. Joseph's Chapel on May 6, 2012. And I would like to reach out to Nancy Stevens, because I believe those are the windows that she did. Does anybody can verify that? Anybody know that if those are Nancy Stevens's creations? Okay. Anyhow, the book ends.
Yes.
Yes, what?
Yes, they are.
Okay, thank you.
As far as I know, yeah.
She's very artistic. The book ends with that last page, and the point of her doing it this way was that this has been the story of the building of Christ Church, the bones and sinew of our church. But the congregation is its beating heart. The real story of Christ Church happens when we walk out of the red doors on Sunday. It continues with various parish ministries we support with our time, talent, and energy. And the book ends, and most especially, the next page of it, I think she wanted you to put your own picture in it. That's what the thing was. So there was a spot there in the book about that. That ends the book, but I have a few more things to talk about. I want to talk about a few stories that some of the people who had been in church for a long time shared with me. So Shirley Perkins, and if she's on here, she'll correct me later, but Shirley remembered that there was just the narthex. So there was no nave yet, and she remembered the folding chairs. Everyone brought their own prayer books. This was the 50s, and Reverend Bright and Father Perry were there then, and I remembered Father Perry. Father Perry was very ecumenically minded and encouraged education. Parishioners were encouraged to volunteer at Head Start in North Portland as teachers' aides. For every volunteer that helped at Head Start, it helped pay for one teacher. It was also at this time that Father Perry encouraged folks to go out to visit other parishes, such as the Catholic Church, a synagogue, and other faiths, to be just aware of the other religions and to increase their awareness. In addition, Shirley, who is a very humble, lovely lady, was very involved with helping a Bosnian family. I forget what year this was, but they were very involved, and Michael Doughton, and I don't know if Cheryl was, but a group of formed, and they helped them find a home, took them to appointments. Michael helped them with resumes, and on and on and on. And I always thought it would be wonderful if our church could do that again with the Syrian family or somebody like that. I touched base with Ann Black, and she was, of course, a longtime member, 50 years. And she shared that she remembered a very successful bazaar that took place in the 60s. They served soup, dessert, and coffee, and lots of pastries and breads and poinsettias were sold. She herself, of course, made 600 pecan tassies. She also remembered Rector John Vance, who was there about 1954. He was very well liked, and they lived in a house where the lower parking area is today. She can also remember women in the church wore dresses and no pants were allowed, and the heads were to be covered. Altar ladies, the same thing, no pants, heads covered up. Interesting. Now, Adrienne Brockman shared some information, and she and her family came to Christ Church in 1948 as a 9-year-old. Her memories were of the first priest was Father Val Spinoza. He and his family lived in a home on a large piece of property located on the lake, which was owned by the diocese. It was on Maple Circle off of South Shore. The diocese also owned a church camp at Gearhart. Bishop Dagwell, an elderly bachelor, would swim in the ocean with us in his ancient bathing suit, she remembered, the kind you see in the old movies. Later, the Maple Circle property was purchased by Ralph and Shirley Cohn. You will see a watercolor painting by Shirley Cohn in the office area of the Christ Church. I'm not sure if it's still there. I haven't been into the office forever. The next priest, Father Edwin West, was a widower, and he tended towards pageantry. There were two main guilds, St. Nicholas and St. Margaret's. Sometime after Reverend Vance became rector, he abolished the guilds because he believed the guilds harmed the goal of everyone interacting. He said that women tended to socialize within their guild and to exclude others. Then she went off to college in 1956. So I tried to get something from Dorothea Beckwith, but I didn't want to harass people. So those are some history snippets. The last one I was going to share was something that means a lot to me. Let's see. Well, I forgot to say about there's so much wonderful art in our church, and especially out here in the Memorial Garden. And we we would like to do another session in the spring on just simply the art in this church, because there's so much of it. Just a minute. Let's see. I have enjoyed, through the many years, gazing up at the lovely bronze cross. And I wondered if you'd ever wondered about its origins. I know I have, and I wanted to share with you who sculpted it. It was created by the sculptor Al Goldsby. According to Helen Lindgren, who was a neighbor of the Morden family, Goldsby was commissioned to create the cross by Burke and Alice Ann Morden in memory of their younger son, Keith. They were members of the Christ Church, and we believe it to be about 1964. I was trying to get from a couple folks, and my sister Jenny remembers Mom telling us a story, but I couldn't verify it. We thought the hanging cross once was by the altar, over by the altar. And I can't verify that. So I don't know when they decided to hang it, but I love it. And Al Goldsby studied under Tom Hardy, a well-known artist who devoted his life portraying Oregon's natural bounty. Having Hardy as a teacher, mentor, and friend opened the doors for Goldsby, and his works can still be found at the Lloyd Center. There is a hanging mobile above one of the escalators that I went over and looked at, quite lovely. It's called Free Flow. And then I think there's still something over at the Portland Art Museum. And if you Googled him, there's still works online you can look at. I just personally have wonderful memories of looking up at the cross, looking up at the rafters, getting lost in the rafters, and especially sitting in the pews when I was a young girl. And, you know, maybe being restless and Mom just kind of holding my hand. And so I have just wonderful memories that go back to the 60s. And so there you have it.
Thank you.
Beautiful.
Yeah, Evie, enjoyed that.
Evie, if you want more discussion, maybe we could get you back up full and stop the share screen. We can see each other better.
Do that. Just a minute. Oh, okay. How do I get that big?
Just click out of that on your
screen. I'll lose you. Just a minute.
No, you won't.
All right.
I hope.
If not, it's been nice talking to you.
If not, come back. Come back in.
Well, right now my box is really small, but who would like to, anybody want to jump in? And
I would like, this is Elaine, and I would like to jump in. If you look at your slide 25, just before Al Goldsby, you will see the stained glass that was there before the big organ came in. And when the organ came in, one of the concerns was that it was going to block some of the, the stained glass is now in a cross shape.
Oh.
And so they blocked some windows off. I don't know what they did with those pieces, but that was the more of the original configuration of the stained glass.
Elaine, was it the same scene that we see?
What you're on slide 25, you'll see a pane at the top, and then you see three panes across,
right?
Two rows, and now you don't see as much. You see across,
but it's the same glass, only less of it.
Less of it, yes.
Okay.
It'd be nice to know. I might have missed what you just said, but Do you think that stained glass came at the same time as all the stained glass?
My memory of it doesn't include that. So my guess is that might've been at the beginning. I could be wrong. But I do remember the glass on the sides changing from that gold pebble glass as they had a fundraiser and people would dedicate to their family and, you know, purchase panels of it.
Uh-huh.
And that happened in several different times.
Well, Evie, I want to thank you for the presentation. It was really very interesting to me to hear about the history and the various locations that the church has had. And even more so, I loved hearing about your mother. I could hear the love that you have for her. And my goodness, it's just wonderful to hear her engagement and how she got several things started with the church. And then the last thing I want to say is I really love the music of Pema. And again, it was such a gift on Sunday as it is any time that we hear your group. Thank you so much for that.
And as I said, we get to hear and see them next time. Two songs that were made at our request. Mm-hmm. And they're really beautiful. So that's next week.
As you can imagine, we can't perform anywhere. Well, I mean, we used to perform at Pittock Mansion, the airport, Spring Ridge, Charbonneau, but we are going to perform outside, probably in the rain, at Carmen Oaks Memory Care on Sunday.
Wow.
I wish I had, you know, plexiglass roof I could have four people carry above us.
Well, what time, Evie?
3:00 is the time, and that's where our father was in memory care. Beautiful, wonderful place. Really good care at the memory care. So we'll be performing in their courtyard downstairs, and then I think to the side of the building for anybody that lives upstairs, which is where Norma and Grant Jennings lived. And oh boy,
Gail Boyd is there.
Oh, Gail Goyd, downstairs in the memory care, yes. It's a wonderful place. If you have
Evie?
Yes.
Is my picture coming up?
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, at least I see it. Does everybody see Holly?
No.
Okay. I can only see four.
Go ahead.
Your view.
I saw Holly earlier, but I don't see her now.
Well, you can scroll down until you find her.
I scrolled all the way through.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, and I'm not, there she is. There she is. Got her.
Okay.
Okay. I just wanted to say that I work in the Altar Guild, and I'm in the sacristy. I even was there after 9 months. I went on last Friday. And your mom was so involved in Altar Guild, and she taught me so much. But she still has notes there about, and I saw one last week, and it was, this chasuble was made by so-and-so in 1954.
Mm.
And so there are still like notes, all kinds of notes from your mom about the history. And she taught me, I mean, she knew every piece that and who had done it and why it was done. And she knew the history was going to be lost, and most of it has been. So she left her notes behind. And wow. It's just very wonderful. Also, what I learned on, there was a small funeral last Friday. So I was putting some things out for that. And I talked to Allison briefly, and they're going to be decorating the church somewhat. And she said that they had found this long storage area that nobody had known about. this very small, very weird, long space. And they had been doing some wiring for an internet. And they found this long piece of beautiful ornate wood that used to be on the altar somewhere. And they're gonna look at how they can use that.
Wow. Well, I was gonna say, I think it'd be neat just for future, because we're not all gonna be around, you know, little placards, they don't have to be ugly and us, you know, just somewhere tucked where someone go, oh, okay. Oh, that's how these embroidered, this is who did the embroidered pillows that we kneel on every Sunday. Or, oh, and I do have something on the hanging cross. I have the picture of Al Goldsby actually up there with a placard that says, you know, where it came from and when it came to the church. Because I just think that, well, that's so important.
I think that it's right by where the Advent candles are on that yes. small wall. Hmm.
There's so much, yeah, so much in the church. That's why I think that'd be a really interesting, when you just said something like chastable, I'm like, what is she talking about? Chastable. That's why I would like a seminar on what the altar guild is all about. Just me.
Yeah. Kathy and Evie.
Yeah, go Bonnie.
When you were talking about the artwork at Christ Church, there's a piece of art that I don't think most people know about, and I'm just assuming that it's still there, but sometime in the last 8 years or so, 9 years, someone gave to the church the most exquisite, huge porcelain of the Last Supper. Have any of you seen it? It's almost tabletop size. It's probably 4 feet long and maybe 2 feet deep or 3 feet deep. And it's like a Yadro porcelain.
Oh,
I think that's the material. Wow. And it is absolutely exquisite. The fingers on the figures. The last I knew, it was sitting on a table in the far back of the office area where it sort of the wall curves around to the safe room and so on. Kathy, your husband probably has come across it. But one of the reasons that I was always given that it wasn't displayed is that it is so fragile. And so, you know, if they put it out in the narthex. But when I was still working at the church in the finance office as treasurer and so on, the value of it was about $25,000. And it's just an exquisite piece. And to my knowledge, it did not come from a member of the church. But Dale Boss knows a little bit more about the history of it, I think. And I think it's something that someone should look into.
Well, I do know that if we opened up, isn't the memorial book over by when you first enter the church on your left, it's underneath a head statue. It's a locked yep. box, but isn't that the history of gifts given?
Yes.
It's supposed to be, but when I was there, I'm not sure it was being kept up to date.
I just think that would be very fascinating to look through it. And we could
learn I think you're right.
The art.
Someone could do that for a program for WIS.
Oh yeah.
Sorry, I'm not there. I would do it.
Well, we can have you talk to Dale.
I will, as a matter of fact.
Yeah.
I will, because I do talk with him periodically.
Okay.
And I will talk with him and see what he knows, and I will let you know.
Great.
Evie, I see Shirley now. She has her picture up.
Hi, Shirley.
I wonder if she might like to say something here at this point. She's saying no.
Muted.
You're muted.
You're on mute. Do you want to unmute?
Can you hear me?
Yes,
can we see everybody's picture again?
Can you hear me?
Yeah. We can see you, but maybe tip your screen so we can see your face instead of your forehead.
I tipped it as far as I could. It won't go any further.
Okay.
Yeah. Well, I want to thank Evie. That was a wonderful presentation. And I think I hope we've all seen Margaret's book, those of us who get to church.
Can we move this page and see everybody's face?
Please. Well, all I see is Evie's little dog.
The darling dog.
Can you post this?
Yes. Evie, if you can go down to your share screen and unshare.
Oh, hold on.
Kathleen, are you actually in the church or is that a background you had done?
Evie's at home, I think.
I'm looking at Kathleen.
Kathleen.
It was a picture Steve Whitaker had taken of a couple of Christmases ago.
Okay.
Evie, just on the green button that says share screen, if you push it again, it'll say unshare.
Okay.
That's the easiest thing.
Stop share.
Yeah,
there we go. Yay.
Okay.
Yes. Well,
Bobby wanted to say something.
No, I just wanted to see everyone. Thank you.
I know. We figured it out, Evie. You know, we're still figuring out our technology. But I want to tell you that Paul came home and he's maybe going to help me play that song after all that I wanted to play. But maybe in a few minutes after we're through with this.
Anybody?
So Bonnie, do you have any idea where that might be stored?
Well, it was just on a tabletop in either the former rector's office or just in the hall. That there's a hallway if you were headed down to the rector's office, uh-huh, and you sort of veered a little bit to your left, to your right, not going into the finance office, but past that. It was sitting on a table there. It's huge.
Okay.
So but it was there a year and a half ago when Chris and I were taking centering prayer with Allison. And,
oh, yes.
And so but that was a year and a half ago. I don't know if it's there now.
Oh, I'd love to, you know, maybe we could ask somebody in the church office, like Julie, could you take a picture of it? I'd love to see it. You know? Yeah.
It's a white alabaster.
Yeah.
Is that correct, Bonnie?
Well, I don't know. I'm not an art person, so I don't know. All I know is it reminds me of the big Yadro porcelains.
Right.
That are so beautifully done. And I've seen individual Yadro porcelains mostly, but many years ago, I had a friend who had a big tabletop display of one, very much like hers wasn't as large as this one. But I think it was donated while Jeremy was there at some point. So it hasn't been there a terribly long time, but it was, I hadn't thought about your idea, Evie, that it might be in that memorial book, but that's a good place to look.
Well, I'd love to take a look at that. Obviously it's under lock and key, but when we work on that next topic for the spring,
mm-hmm. Yes.
I mean, it would just be fascinating because it's unbelievable the amount of art.
Yes.
I mean, that Celtic, I never say it right, the Celtic cross out in the Memorial Garden, which is in honor of the coming son who died young, right, Holly?
Yes.
Yes. Yeah.
It's just gorgeous. And of course, like being on the St. Fiacre, cleaning the garden, we see all those things and the sheep, the stone sheep in the gardens. My mom and dad are right there and I'm going to be there. So I love those sheep. Just a lot of beautiful art there.
Well, another thing tied into this, I'm not sure that there is a good inventory of when I was still working actively at the diocese in the finance department with them, they were hounding for a good inventory if, you know, some disaster would happen.
Oh my goodness.
Yeah.
You know,
that could have changed.
You all know Tom and Emily Cummins, yes?
Yeah.
Because I have, they were in our dinner group and I had this really neat picture of them.
Oh.
Yeah. Great.
Such a neat guy.
Yeah. Father Cummins baptized at least several of our, of my sister's grandchildren. Yeah.
Great.
And she's the one that told me about the hanging cross.
Oh, is that right, Emily?
Bonnie, Paul wants to know, what is the statue of that may he look around?
It's not, it's small. The figures are probably maybe 8 inches or so, but it is a complete scene of the Last Supper.
Okay.
It has multiple figures in it. Wow. It's hard to describe. It's like looking down on a gathering of some kind, if you were up above it, looking down and seeing it. But it's primarily, it's focused on the Last Supper. So the main front of it is the table with the Jesus and the disciples and so on.
You know, we're really lucky that Steve Whitaker is part of our congregation and he took that picture that's behind Kathleen and is such a great photographer that, and I know that he would love to help us photograph this art. That's
a great idea.
That is his specialty.
That's what should be done for insurance purposes, is there should be a photograph of every one of the art pieces.
Uh-huh.
I tried to get, when I was on the vestry, tried to get the youth group to work on that, take on that project, do some of that inventory, but
that's a great idea. It's like a scavenger hunt. Look for this sculpture. Yes.
Yep.
Whoever gets the most sculptures win a prize.
Well, and as we're finding out, there are a lot of storage spaces at Christ Church that nobody knows about, and who knows what's in.
Can you tell us where that storage spot was? Upstairs?
I'll tell you more next week. Okay. No, it was someplace that no one who's there now knew anything about until they were doing some wiring. And they, you know, it was just a spot. It was a long, strange spot. I probably have some in my house too.
Well, I know, you know, it probably isn't that interesting to people that are new, or that, or maybe that's wrongly my sense. But those of us who have been here for a long time, it's just important. And like my, I don't know, it's probably because my mom saved everything. And you can see pictures of when they were married. And I have some of those teapots still, or she just kept things really, really well. Mm-hmm. And then my other sister, before mom died, she took pictures of mom's heirlooms and she did a history so that she could then send this binder to all of our siblings, because we have so many heirlooms that actually, sadly, that next generation, they don't care because it's not Pottery Barn stuff.
The wedding silver and the wedding china.
Yeah, I mean, sadly, it's going to, you know, and speaking in our family, it's going to go, and once another generation gets, it's like, oh, okay, here's this painting of Moby Dick. Well, what's it? Well, that was my dad's background. He was from New England, you know, and this was a famous painting with Moby Dick, or actually a whale being hunted. Now, I don't like hunting of animals, but I do love whales. So, and my point is that it's important. History is important.
Well, and don't forget that the Episcopal Church is like a three-legged stool, and it's based on scripture, tradition, which I think history comes with tradition as well as reason. So I think it's an important part of the church mm-hmm. to learn the history, to know the history.
And Evie, one thing that my mother did for us is she would write up the history of a needlepoint, mm-hmm. and she just had it on the back. And let me tell you, I have a china set from an ancestor, but I don't know who. And it's so sad that, you know, mom wasn't able to glue that information onto the pot.
And I have some living mom's history, you know, her voice telling us of this quilt I have that's 150 years old. And that is special. Before we go, you know, get the history on some of this. But anyhow, there's a lot of art in this church, inside and out.
Yeah, I think that'll be fun to do. It'll be fun to put that together.
And a lot of new art, like that sculpture in front of the church. I think it's by Mr. Gertz.
Yeah.
You know, it almost the sun shines through it. I don't know enough about that sculpture, but it seemed like it was made partly of stone or something, because when I was there Friday, the sun shone through it. Hmm. And yet it was, yeah. I don't know anything about that. Does anybody know about that sculpture?
I don't.
No, but it would be nice to find out more about the windows for St. Joseph's also from Nancy Wild. I mean, if she did them. It'd be nice to know what she had in mind, or what, you know, what was her inspiration.
I'll be working on that, Holly.
Okay. Shannon Leach would know who did them.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Good point.
Well,
I made notes.
I would like to get my husband involved here so we can. And forgive me, because I have done this successfully before, but not today. So I'm going to try to play something beautiful for you and for Advent.
Okay, so go to church.
So, okay. Come around.
Yeah, just go to church.
You guys know Paul.
Hello.
Okay. Hi, Paul.
Hello,
Paul.
Hello.
Okay, this might take a minute. Sure. Evie, I want to thank you. That was fabulous.
Thank you.
Thanks, Evie.
Really good, Evie. Thanks
very much, Evie.
I've had many months to work on it.
And if we can get the song going, that will be kind of the end. And if you have headphones, the sound is so much better. It's gorgeous. Do you all know Judy Collins?
Mm-hmm. Oh, yes.
This is from her. So here's my...
Did you go to share screen? Okay, go to advance. Okay. So music, the computer sound. Okay. Then I go back to share. Okay, you're sharing your computer sound, so now play the song.
Attention Portland, Oregon homeowners. Are you tired of paying PG&E and Pacific Power expensive electricity bills?
Sorry, we have
well, if that's the case, you could be saving upwards of $100, $200, or even $300 a month.
It's an ad. There you go.
It always occurred to me that poor Joseph in this story never really got very much attention. No angel comes to talk to Joseph about what's going on. He's sort of left to, I suppose, deduce. However, this is a song that gives a little glimpse of Joseph and his point of view. Joseph was an old man, an old man was he, when he married Virgin Mary in the land of Galilee. When he wedded Virgin Mary in the land of Galilee. and cherries, as thick as might be seen. Where were berries and cherries, as thick as might be seen? Then bespoke Mary in a voice meek and mild, pluck me one cherry, Joseph, for I am with child. Pluck me one cherry, Joseph, for I am with child. Oh, then bespoke Joseph in a voice most unkind, let him pluck thee a cherry that brought thee with child. Let him pluck thee a cherry that brought thee with child. That my mother may have some. Bow down the tallest tree, that my mother may have some. Then bow down the tallest tree unto his mother's hand. She said, see, Joseph, I have cherries at command. She said, see, Joseph, I have cherries at command.
What a voice.
Beautiful.
Yes. Thank you.
Just unshare.
Where?
Up the top. Go all the way up the top. Okay. On your Zoom. Where's your Zoom at?
I don't know.
Well, go to your Zoom. There you
go. Okay. I just figured out how to get out of it. I'm just so glad Paula came home.
Yay, Paul.
Yeah.
Wasn't that just beautiful?
That was beautiful. Judy Collins is amazing. Yeah. And just a simple music background.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Just probably, yeah.
Well, anyway, so bless you all and see you next week. It's party, Christmas party time next week.
Okay. Thank you.
Well.
Have a good week.
Thank you so much.
You have a good week.
Kathy.
Okay. Well, the pointer is gone.
Keep trying to read.
I got it.